I want to thank you all for joining us today here in New York. I know we have many people watching on our live stream as well, so welcome to all of you who are joining us virtually. My name is Jason Bordoff. I'm a professor here at Columbia School of International Public Affairs, and I direct the Center on Global Energy Policy. Tonight we're going to talk about OPEC with a distinguished set of experts. I'll introduce them in a moment. Let me first quickly say this event, like all those at the center, is being webcast. The full video will be available online. The podcast audio will be available online. For those of you watching online, as well as people who are sitting in the room and shy perhaps, you can also participate in our discussion at the end and ask questions of our panelists through Twitter, through the hashtag CGEP events, and then our Twitter handle at Columbia U Energy. It's an honor today, and quite a timely one at that, to welcome to Columbia's Center on Global Energy Policy His Excellency Secretary General Mohammad Barkindo. For the past 2 years, we've seen one of the steepest oil price collapses in history, raising many questions and punditry and commentary about the future of OPEC, the relevance of OPEC, after OPEC, led by Saudi Arabia, opted not to cut production in November of 2014. And of course, that narrative has changed in the last few weeks, with OPEC nations reversing course, reaching an agreement to cut production, and then coupling that with an agreement with non-OPEC countries to contribute to those production cuts as well. So these events have raised many important questions about the role and relevance of OPEC, combined with longer-term questions about the impact of OPEC on the oil markets, the impact of U.S. shale, the impact of potential decarbonization and climate policy, among many other uncertainties in the in the global oil market. So it's very timely again to have Secretary General Barkindo with us in New York today. Secretary General Barkindo was tapped to lead OPEC in June of this year. It's an organization he knows very well, serving in various key roles at OPEC for a quarter century now, including as part of Nigeria's delegation to OPEC, as Nigeria's national representative on OPEC's Economic Commission Board, as acting Secretary General of OPEC, and as Nigeria's representative on OPEC's Board of Governors in 2009 and 2010. He has a long history in the oil industry, including as Group Managing Director of the Nigerian National Petroleum Corporation, holds degrees from Ahmadu Bello University, Oxford, Southeastern University in Washington, D.C., along with many honorary degrees. So His Excellency is going to make some brief remarks for about 20 minutes or so, and then Jorge Leon from OPEC is going to spend 10 or 15 minutes presenting some of the highlights from OPEC's oil outlook. And then after that, that'll leave us around 45, 50 minutes for a discussion and a conversation where I will talk with His Excellency, joined by two of our senior fellows at the Center on Global Energy Policy, Adrian Lajous and Antoine Halff. And I'll just briefly introduce them now so we can move right to the conversation. Adrian is the former CEO of Pemex. He's personally participated in negotiations within OPEC and has watched OPEC for many years, played a central role in the late 1990s in facilitating secret negotiations between Saudi Arabia, Venezuela, and Mexico in an attempt to stabilize oil prices, and tells that story in quite fascinating detail, drawing on his personal logs and some documents that had not been made public before in the Oxford Energy Forum, I think it was May 2015, the edition that honored Robert Mabro. He's been a chairman of the Oxford Institute for Energy Studies, served on the Board of Trustees of El Colegio de Mexico, and from 2001 to 2011 was a senior energy advisor to McKinsey and serves on various corporate boards. And then Antoine Halff directs the center's oil market research program. He previously served as the chief oil analyst at the International Energy Agency in Paris, where he wrote the agency's medium-term oil market report, the monthly oil market report that is closely watched. And his 20-year career as one of the world's leading oil analysts spans the worlds of government, international organizations, consulting, Wall Street, academia, and many other spheres. I won't recite all the positions he's held, but it's been great to have him with us for about 2 years now here at Columbia. With that, please join me in welcoming His Excellency Secretary Barkindo for your remarks. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jason, for those very warm words of welcome to this great institution, Citadel of Learning. And thank you also for providing this forum, which is beginning to look like a reunion of some sorts with all friends and colleagues I haven't met for quite some time, that I'm so pleased to meet with you. It's a great honor, Jason, to be asked to come to this very important center of learning in this distinguished city of research, development, and learning, the Columbia University, to participate with you in exchanging our views and our perspectives. It's my first time in Columbia, but I think every soul from whichever part of the globe knows something about this great institution of learning. I'm told that it is the oldest institution in the state of New York. It was founded by royalty, specifically by King George II of England, and it is home to the annually awarded Pulitzer Prize honoring excellence in journalism and the arts. This does not even mention the notable alumni that includes some of the founding fathers of this great country, the United States. Three U.S. presidents passed through this the walls of this great institution. Many other heads of states, Supreme Court justices, jurists, Academy Award winners, Nobel laureates, and I think I recall including many of my lecturers in college and professors also used to continuously remind us in classes that they are an alumni of Columbia, so we should not challenge them. It is also a great privilege to be at this Center of Global Energy Policy, one of the leading global institutions for energy dialogue and policy. Given recent events in the oil market, it's obviously an extremely interesting time for energy dialogue and debate. It's often said that the Chinese have a very favorite saying that may we live in interesting times. And I think this is one of those interesting times. I hope to be able to highlight some of the most pertinent viewpoints of OPEC, our organization's outlook, over both the short and long term, together with my colleagues who have joined me in this mission. And Jason, I must confess that coming here from Vienna, almost all my colleagues wanted to come to this great center, and I promised them next time maybe we should do it in rotation. When Columbia University was founded back in 1754, the modern petroleum industry had not even been born. It would be more than 100 years before what many agree to be the first commercial oil well was drilled, Edwin Drake's well of 1859 in Titusville, Pennsylvania, which is widely believed to be the first modern oil well and the one that ushered in the major oil boom that led to the dawn of a new era of industrialization and prosperity that was unprecedented. It is interesting to note that this oil well initially yielded just 25 barrels a day. Oil was then seen as somewhat obscure commodity, but today its existence is vital to billions of people across the world. Although I should also underline here that there remain in this globe of ours about 1.3 billion souls that still have no access to modern energy services. It is critical that energy poverty is eradicated in all its ramifications. This is one of the pillars of the UN Millennium Development Goals, and I'm encouraged to know that this great center shares these views and aspirations. Today, the size, scope, and complexity of the global oil market make it almost unique among physical commodities. Currently, more than 94 million barrels of oil are produced and consumed every day, compared to the era of Drake in Titusville, Pennsylvania, when 25 barrels were produced. Beyond the magnitude of this trade, the strategic importance of oil and the crucial role that it plays in the global economy make it probably the most strategic engine of the global economy. The true scale of the industry and its strategic value to both producers and consumers of oil are important to producers as well as consumers, to governments as well as companies, to households, to all stakeholders. But one recurring decimal among all these stakeholders is the word stability. Stability is vital for producers in terms of security of demand. Stability is vital for consumers in terms of security of supply. Stability is vital for all industry stakeholders. Over the past couple of years, however, stability on a sustainable basis has eluded the industry to the detriment of producers, consumers, as well as the global economy in general. This is reflected in the sharp crude price declines observed between June 2014 and January 2016, which Jason just made reference to, when the OPEC reference basket price fell by an unprecedented 80% within a very short period of time. It is the largest percentage fall in the five cycles of sharp price declines we have observed over the past three decades. Since the start of 2016, however, prices have recovered somewhat, but price volatility and great uncertainties in the market as well as the industry continues unabated. We have seen supply outpace demand, which led to a sharp global inventory buildup between mid-2014 and the beginning of 2016. This year, OECD commercial oil stock levels have seen little change, but they still remain more than 300 million barrels above the five-year average. And here, I must also remind us that at its peak earlier this year, it had reached about 380 million barrels a day over the five-year average. Moreover, we have also seen a rise in non-OECD inventories, plus an expansion in some non-OECD strategic petroleum reserves. In both 2015 and 2016, we have witnessed a dramatic contraction in oil industry investments. For example, global oil and gas exploration and production spending fell by around 26% in 2015, and a further 22% drop is anticipated in 2016. when you combine this, it equates to an estimated $300 billion of lost investment in the industry. This will impact not only on new projects coming on stream, but new discoveries as well. And we have witnessed significant job losses in the industry, as well as increasing financial and operational stress for many operating companies. In 2016, it has been evident that oil producers, as well as most consumers, have come to comprehend and agree on the gravity of the current oil cycle, the most severe cycle among all the five or six, depending on which of the oil historians you talk to. This cycle has also lasted longer than most cycles, if not all. Throughout 2016, there have been numerous bilateral and multilateral meetings, as well as consultations by stakeholders concerning these challenges. These multilateral consultations, sometimes bilateral, gathered pace in August this year when I assumed office in Vienna, with many OPEC member countries as well as non-OPEC countries, including even our sovereigns, heads of states and governments, who have engaged themselves in the process of rebalancing this market. From OPEC's perspective, these extensive bilateral and multilateral consultations, meetings, formal and informal, intervention of our sovereigns at the highest levels of government behind the scenes, led us to the landmark Algiers Accord in Algeria on the 28th of September. When I arrived in Algiers on the eve of this conference and ran into a battery of journalists at Algiers Airport, I was almost speechless because I didn't know what to tell them. I was not sure whether we were going to come out of Algiers with a meaningful, credible agreement that will convince the market that OPEC was back on its statutory function and role. The urgent need of stimulating the acceleration of the drawdown of stock overhang, bringing the market rebalancing forward, and ensuring that the much needed investments return to the industry on a timely fashion was the principal objective of the Algiers Accord. The Algiers Accord reaffirmed OPEC's continued commitments to stable markets in the interest of both producers as well as consumers. Moreover, it also initiated a process of consultations on a structured basis between OPEC and non-OPEC oil producing countries to establish a platform and a framework from where both OPEC and non-OPEC could take proactive measures that will ensure a balanced oil market on a sustainable basis. And this structured and framework producing this global platform was designed on different layers, one at a policy level and the other at a technical level. I'm glad to report to this distinguished audience that we have almost completed the architecture, the various building blocks of this platform. I'm sure everyone here can appreciate the road to success is not always easy to navigate. Turning the Algiers Accord into a lasting and viable solution for oil market stability took a great deal of hard work, commitment, courage, and compromise from OPEC member countries and many OPEC, non-OPEC producers. And following 2 months of intensive and determined efforts from September 28th, when we adopted the Algiers Accord in Algeria, right up to the Vienna Agreement on the 30th of November in Vienna, a lot had happened, and I look forward to extensive discussions with this distinguished audience during our panel interactions. This landmark decision by OPEC, as well as the pledge made by a number of non-OPEC producers at a joint ministerial meeting in Vienna on 10th December, underlines a shared and deep resolve to return much-needed stability to the market and the industry as a whole. Through a shared vision among both OPEC and non-OPEC producers, collaborative and reasoned action was taken to address the prevailing market realities. It was a commitment to all oil industry stakeholders, as well as one to the broader global community, through the restoration of oil market stability and the potential positives of this for the global economy. It is also important to highlight that these recent decisions should not only be viewed as a short-term necessity. Yes, the short-term is in all of our minds, but as we all know, this is very much a medium to long-term business. We need to view these actions as vital to long-term oil market stability. The value of this is readily apparent in OPEC's recently launched 10th edition of our World Oil Outlook, which provides comprehensive analysis of key industry dynamics, as well as detailed insights into the challenges and uncertainties the industry faces. In the 2016 edition, the outlook shows that oil demand is estimated to reach over 109 million barrels a day of oil by 2040, an increase of over 16 million barrels a day. This expansion will obviously require significant and timely investments. Moreover, new barrels are needed to not only increase production, but also to accommodate for declining rates from existing fields. Overall, we see oil-related investment requirements of around $10 trillion over the period to 2040. This investment figure puts the need for sustainable market stability in stark perspective. Distinguished colleagues, the experience of 2016 has shown us that the importance of cooperation and dialogue at all levels between oil industry stakeholders has never been greater. We believe that our future will increasingly be one of energy interdependence. We do not live in a world of independent energy nations. It all points to the need to continually enhance dialogue and cooperation with innovative thinking, collaboration, and swift action between all stakeholders where and when appropriate. This lies behind our established and evolving dialogues with the European Union, China, India, the Russian Federation, other non-OPEC producers, the International Energy Agency, the International Energy Forum, the IMF, the World Bank, the G20, and others. It is why OPEC sees benefits in advancing this in the context of this vision that we explore and indeed, I believe, initiated in the last couple of days since we arrived here in Washington, the most important of all energy dialogues with the United States. The U.S. is currently the number one liquids producer at around 13.6 million barrels a day. The number one consumer at just over 20 million barrels a day. The number one importer of liquids at about 9.6 million barrels a day. And the number three exporter of liquids at around 4.6 million barrels a day. It is therefore obvious that any dialogue between producers, particularly OPEC and non-OPEC, without the United States is incomplete. What is in all of our interests is one word. I have uttered on many occasions in this address and in previous interactions. Stability is central to everything we do. It is overarching concern that links us all. We need stability for investment and capacity expansion to guarantee supply levels are adequate and sufficient, and to enable producers to respond quickly and appropriately in terms of unexpected supply commitments. We need stability for investors and producers to realize a fair return from the exploitation of their non-renewable resource. We need stability for consumers to receive reliable and secure supplies. For your information, distinguished colleagues, after our historic decision in Vienna, my first August visitor to my office was the Japanese Minister of Meti, who came to congratulate us for this timely historic decision that we entered into between ourselves and 11 countries outside of OPEC, because in his opinion, the decision, this historic agreement, was not only good for producers, it was also good for consumers and therefore for the global economy. And for Japan in particular, that has been battling deflation for years, in his opinion, this decision will accelerate the Japanese economy's emergence from this deflationary period. We need stability for the market to react and respond to future unforeseen events. We need stability in all its forms. It guarantees a more balanced market today, which will also guarantee a balanced market in the future. On this point, Jason, if you allow me, I will yield the floor to my colleague, Dr. Jorge Leon, who will share with us our outlook, some perspectives of our outlook. I believe we have also brought some copies for colleagues who may like to use this outlook either in your research or other endeavors. But finally, let me also, on behalf of OPEC, thank you in particular, Jason, and your colleagues at this great center, this citadel of learning, for giving us the opportunity to engage with such a distinguished audience through which we hope to establish this very important energy dialogue with the United States. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Thank you, Jason, for the invitation. It's a really great pleasure to be here. Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Leon. I'm one of the authors of the Outlook, together with a bunch of great experts back in Vienna. So welcome to this presentation. It's meant to be a short presentation where I'm going to give you the key takeaways from the WU. In case you're active in the social network as well, I encourage you to also use the hashtag WU2016. So the World Outlook provides a lot of detail on very important issues affecting our industry. But for this presentation, I wanted to keep it short. So we'll go through We'll review how the energy outlook evolves up to 2040, and then we'll focus a little bit more on the oil market up to 2040. And finally, a new piece of analysis that I want to raise your attention to is that in this year's outlook, we have added a scenario analysis based on the Paris Climate Change Agreement. In particular, we analyze how the changes in the future energy policies could affect the energy outlook. So let me start with the energy outlook up to 2040. And the key takeaway here is that energy demand will continue to grow, in particular 40% between 2014 and 2040. In 2014, we had 274 million barrels of oil equivalent per day of energy demand. In 2040, we expect to have 382 million barrels of oil equivalent per day. And most of that growth will be coming from the developing countries, as you can see in that table. 2.1% per annum average growth for developing countries, and even for some regions, that growth is even higher. Have a look at India here in this graph. And energy demand in this country will increase at around 3.7% per annum, which is a massive growth. Energy demand in the OECD region and country is expected to peak sometime around 2030 and then start declining on the back of energy efficiency policies, but also lower population growth rate and lower GDP growth forecast. This is from the regional point of view. From the fuels point of view, the message is quite clear. We see that the shift from fossil fuels to renewables will continue in the future. Fossil fuels currently account for 81% of the energy mix. In the future, 2040, we expect that number to be 77% of the energy mix. And this is basically because we expect a fast growth from other renewables. That's mainly wind and solar. But specifically for oil, we expect it to remain as the main, as the most important fuel of choice until the late 2030s, when it's afterwards overtaken by gas. And this is a very interesting graph. This is the growth of energy demand by fuel type between 2014 and 2040. And here we see that the majority of the demand is going to be satisfied by gas, but also oil and other renewables will play a very important role in the future energy mix. And an important observation here as well is that oil and gas together will satisfy 53% of the energy needs of the world by 2040. Now let's focus a little bit more on the oil market outlook up to 2040. And let's start with the demand side. And as His Excellency mentioned, we expect that oil demand will reach 109.4 million barrels per day by 2040. That's an increase of 16.4 million barrels per day. This is on a global basis, but regionally, the picture is a little bit different. We expect that demand will increase significantly in the developing countries, fostered by higher population growth rates, higher GDP growth, and also increasing income levels in the developing countries. While oil demand in the OECD region, we expect it to drop by around 9 million barrels per day. Another important observation that we highlight in the outlook is that the oil demand growth is expected to decelerate in the future. In this graph, we show that between the first 5 years of the forecast period, that's 2015 to 2020, oil demand increases by an average of 1.1 million barrels per day every year. However, towards the end of the forecast period, this growth is only 0.3 million barrels per day. And this is, again, on the back of lower population growth rates in the future, lower GDP growth, but most importantly, energy efficiency policies coming into being enacted. And from the sectorial point of view, it cannot be overemphasized the importance of the road transportation sector as one of the main sources of growth in terms of oil demand. However, we also foresee strong growth in the petrochemical sector and in the aviation sector. I also want to zoom in a little bit more on the road transportation, given the importance of this sector. And as I'm sure you're all aware, almost every day we have news regarding the penetration of electric vehicles in the market. So the outlook provides a very detailed analysis on what is our view on the car fleet and how it will change in the future. So let me start from the beginning. The number of passenger cars will more than double in the future. Currently, we have 1.1 billion passenger cars in the world. And in the future, in 2040, that number will reach 2.1 billion cars in 2040. regionally, most of these additional cars will come from the developing countries. In the OECD region, as you can see in the graph, we expect only very marginal growth in terms of passenger cars due to saturation effects. But it's not only important where those cars are going to be located, but also the type of cars that will be hitting the road in the future. And this is a very interesting graph here where we, in the blue, differentiate between the conventional cars. Those are gasoline, diesel, and LPG pure cars versus what we call the non-conventional vehicles, which includes natural gas, hybrid electric, plug-in hybrid electric, battery electric, and fuel cell vehicles. And the message from this graph is quite clear. We expect that the penetration of the non-conventional cars will increase in the future. Currently, they account for 4% of the car fleet. In 2040, they will represent 22% of the car fleet. And within those non-conventionals, battery electric vehicles are taking the biggest role. By 2040, we expect 141 million battery electric vehicles hitting the road. Now, turning to the supply side of the market, non-OPEC supply in the medium term, we expect it to recover, slow road to recovery, and growth will be coming mainly from Latin America, particularly Brazil, but also US and Canada. The story is a little bit different in the long term. So after the recovery in the medium term, we expect it to remain fairly flat, non-OPEC supply, and then decline post-2030. And while at the beginning of the forecast period, tight crude is the main source of growth, towards the end of the forecast period, oil sands and biofuels start to take over as the source of growth. And with this, we expect that the demand for OPEC crude will increase to 41 million barrels per day in 2040. That will represent around 37% of the world liquid supply. Currently, OPEC crude accounts for 33% of the world liquid. So in a sense, the importance of OPEC crude will increase in the future. I also want to shed a bit of light on the tight crude outlook. In North America, we expect it to recover in the medium term, increase up to 6.3 million barrels per day in 2030, and then decline to 5.4 million barrels per day in 2040. But that's not part of that's only one part of the story. We also expect in the long term supplies additional tight crude barrels from outside North America, particularly in Argentina and in Russia, so that the total tight crude outlook will reach 6.7 million barrels per day in 2030 and then decline to 6 million barrels per day in 2040. And finally, the other side of the other part of the story is the unconventional NGLs. So together, tight oil, which is tight crude plus unconventional NGLs, will account for 10 million barrels per day in 2029. It will then plateau to finally decline below 9 million barrels per day in 2040. So that brings me to my last point. As I mentioned, this is a new piece of analysis. And after the Paris Agreement, there's still a lot of uncertainty on how energy policies will evolve and what will be the implementation paths of those energy policies. So for this matter, we have developed a scenario analysis in the WU where we assume that two scenarios. Scenario A, we assume a faster tightening of emission reduction policies compared to the reference case. So what happens in the world if policies, emission reduction policies are a little bit faster, are tightened a little bit faster than in the reference case? But we also have a scenario B where we assume the timely implementation of both conditional and unconditional INDCs. And this is an extreme scenario. It will be very difficult, of course, to have a timely implementation of both conditional and unconditional INDCs. And the results are quite interesting. On both the scenarios, the global energy demand declines, but also the energy mix picture changes. The demand for fossil fuels is reduced, and coal is the most affected fuel because most of the emission reduction policies are targeting the power generation sector. That's why we also see an increase in the use of renewables and nuclear compared to the reference case. And this will also have an important impact on the CO2 emissions, so that in the scenario B, the total energy-related CO2 emissions could be 14% lower than in the reference case. So key takeaways from this year's World Oil Outlook 2016, energy demand is set to increase by 40%, reaching 382 million barrels per day by 2040. And the energy mix, the shift from fossil fuels to renewables is set to continue in the future. Oil demand also set to increase 109.4 million barrels per day in 2040, but oil demand growth decelerates over the long term. Non-OPEC supply recovers in the medium term, then remains fairly flat to then decline post-2030, and that means that the demand for OPEC crude is set to increase to 41 million barrels per day in 2040. And finally, the changes in energy policies could reduce energy demand and could further shift the energy mix from fossil fuels to renewables. And with this, I finish my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That was a really fascinating overview of the dynamics taking place now within the fast-changing world of OPEC, and a lot of things for us to discuss and chew on. So I want to start with you, Your Excellency, and sort of ask a few follow-up questions. So again, for those watching online or listening online, I'll just remind everyone, I'm Jason Bordoff from the Center on Global Energy Policy. I'm joined by His Excellency Mohammad Barkindo, the Secretary General of OPEC, Antoine Halff, Senior Fellow at the Center on Global Energy Policy, Director of its Oil Market Research Program, and Adrian Lajous, Fellow at the Center as well, the former CEO of Pemex. So, Your Excellency, you talked about the uncertainty when you got to Algiers about whether this would be possible to all come together. Can you give us a little bit of color on the internal dynamics? Why was OPEC able to reach an agreement to cut production? What were the hardest parts? What were the most difficult challenges in bringing people to an agreement? And just pretend no one's listening and tell us a little bit about the internal conversations that what made it possible in the end.
Thank you very much, Jason. Probably in order to respond adequately to your very important question, maybe we may need to step back to 2014 when the market reached its peak and supplies sprung up from far and wide, including very high cost regions, particularly tight oil, both within the United States, Canada, and probably other places, impacting heavily on stocks, raising to levels that were unprecedented. So I think you did not need to be a trader on Wall Street or an analyst to know that the situation was unsustainable, that the market was heading to some form of correction. But where most of us, I don't know whether your center, what you projected at that time, but most analysts and agencies, I think, did not anticipate the gravity of the situation, that this correction was going to be very severe with the prices slashing by an average of 80% across the board within a very short period of time, and also the length that it has taken. I think most projections then were expecting a very short period of correction and the market would rebalance itself. But most of us got it wrong. It had taken this long and with severe consequences on national treasuries of OPEC member countries, including non-OPEC member countries, with severe impact on the balance sheet of operating companies across the supply chain. And this time around, probably for the first time, consuming countries who had always banked on the economic theory that low oil prices or low energy prices would stimulate economic growth. I think probably the center must have done some work on this now because we have seen a disconnect in this theory. This time around, we have not seen a corresponding positive growth in global economic growth responding to the low oil prices that we have seen. Now, you recall that some member countries of OPEC, particularly the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and Venezuela, as well as Qatar, had met with the Russian Federation in February of this year, of 2016, in Doha, in order to begin to explore ways and means of restoring some form of order into the market. Of course, we all believe that the markets in the fullness of time will work and would rebalance itself. But the length of time that it has taken this time, I think frightened most stakeholders, particularly producers, to the extent that we saw them beginning to compare not as early as 2015 on what should be done in order to complement the market, in order to advance the process or bring forward the process of rebalancing.
If I may, part of the reason that rebalancing took so much longer was because OPEC significantly increased production following the price collapse in November 2014. So,
from November 2014 to 2015, we have seen incremental barrels coming from non-OPEC, almost 7 million barrels a day, compared to OPEC's increment of probably less than 2 million barrels a day. So you have to put it in global perspective. But be that as it may, efforts were made in Doha by these four countries. And for the first time, the concept of freeze was introduced into the colloquium. These consultations led to the second Doha meeting in April of this year, where about 18 both OPEC and non-OPEC countries got together and made significant progress in terms of consultations on how to implement this new concept of freeze, on what baselines and what have you. But the geopolitics of the time had also impacted on those talks, and the rest is history. So Doha 2 also failed. And then a new journey was embarked upon from Doha to Algiers. And between Doha to Algiers, several of those consultations took place. I personally, on assumption of office in August of this year, had plunged myself into these consultations that took me to several capitals of OPEC member countries. My first port of call, for obvious reasons, was to go to the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, the biggest producer within the OPEC group, the most leading producer globally. Any supply agreement without the active support and participation of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia would be futile. So I packed my bags and headed to Saudi Arabia and met with King Salman presented my case to him as a newly elected Secretary General confronted with this market situation, and that I came to not only to get his support but to get his guidance on how to proceed. And I was amazed with his level of simplicity, humility. He listened attentively, and he agreed that the market conditions needed faster correction, that no country was insulated from the effects of this cycle, including his own country. So he was fully in support of whatever consensus effort that OPEC could take together with other producers in order to restore stability. And he assured me of the continued support of the kingdom not only to restore this market stability, but to strengthen OPEC in order to, if not avoid this type of cycle, but at least to minimize the impacts going forward. And from there, I headed to Tehran for obvious reasons, to the Islamic Republic of Iran, just coming out of international sanctions with very valid and genuine concerns and aspirations to rebuild their economy, to rebuild the industry, to rebuild their capacity and recover their lost markets, exports. The exports had fallen by more than 50%. At one point, they came down from 2.6, 2.8 million exports to less than 1 million. Mm-hmm. So it was a tough call to expect the Islamic Republic of Iran to join other producers in managing supplies at this period in time. And therefore, I went to meet President Hassan Rouhani, who I must confess I found to be not only deeply knowledgeable person, very philosophical in his thoughts, and very balanced and measured, reminded me that Iran as a founder member of OPEC would never be an obstacle to OPEC reaching decisions, because this is not only in the interest of OPEC, it would be in the interest of the global economy. And Iran is a part of this global economy and has vested interest in restoring stability into this market. With those encouraging words, I felt I was fully armed to confront other members. And of course, Iraq is another special case. Iraq is the second largest producer, but Iraq, as you know very well, is facing some turmoil, fighting war against Daesh. Many of the northern fields are under occupation by Daesh. And also, Iraq in the past had not been part of any supply arrangement for a very long time, at least since the Iran-Iraq war. And as a result of the security situation, there are serious discrepancies between their production data and what is reported by the industry, especially the secondary sources. So it became another big challenge for us. And hence, I had no choice but to brave it, to go to Baghdad. And I went to meet Prime Minister Dr. Haider al-Abadi, a very practical academic coming from your background, a former professor. So he was very businesslike. I found him very engaging and very frank. He's a man of numbers, figures, and he was doing the calculations himself on his desk, on the percentages, on the baselines. I was amazed to see a prime minister very much at home with those details, technical details. And we literally negotiated with him there in his office, where he agreed, one, that it's absolutely necessary for Iraq to join this consensus, to play its own part by limiting its supplies. He told me that there were, in his office, he had the Minister of Finance and Governor of Central Bank, and he told me that these guys informed me that for us to stay afloat in 2017, we needed a minimum of $61 a barrel. I didn't need to be convinced as a result of that, that Iraq had to play its part. So the issue now is how much and from what baseline. He was fully briefed, and he agreed with us that the decision by OPEC to use an average of 6 second resources for all our decisions was a conference decision in which Iraq itself participated in this decision, and therefore it was not advisable to make an exemption for Iraq, where we had a discrepancy of nearly 600,000 barrels a day from what they were reporting and what the world markets were reporting. And he was very considerate, very realistic. He said, yes, I agree with you, because even for us, we are using the second resources to estimate what they are producing in Kurdistan and some of the other areas in the north where they have no control or access to. And secondly, he said, okay, according to my calculations, we need to cut about 3%, and we will cut from that baseline. He earned my respect, and he assured me that I could take his words to the bank. I think with that, I was fully armed, and I became so encouraged to proceed with the rest of the consultations that continued, that took me to Algiers itself before the Algiers conference to meet the leadership as the host, to solicit as host for their support. And don't forget, we primarily went to Algiers to attend the IEF meeting, the International Energy Forum, of which we are all members. And we thought that since all OPEC member countries are also members of the IEF, there was no reason why we should not ask them for a corner room to have some informal talks over tea or coffee. Unknown to us, these informal talks turned out to be the main event of Algiers. But the Prime Minister, Salal, had been an excellent host, and he took leadership and ensured that every OPEC member country showed maximum flexibility. And it was his suggestion that we should turn these informal meetings into a formal conference, because he didn't want us to leave Algiers like we left Doha. He wanted Algiers to be a success. He is a very astute politician, and he persuaded ministers that we should convert this informal into a conference, and we did. And we agreed on this ceiling, a range of 32.5 million barrels a day to 33 million barrels a day. This was based on our production data of August, based on our projections that we needed to cap our production in that range. But in doing that, we also take into account the special circumstances of three countries, member countries: Nigeria, Libya, and the Islamic Republic of Iran. Libya, since the fall of Gaddafi, had lost practically most of its production. From about 1.6 million, they came down to less than 300,000, and still struggling. Nigeria, because of the disturbances in the Niger Delta region, at one point lost between 700 to 900,000 barrels a day out of a production of about 2.2 million barrels a day. The Islamic Republic of Iran, because of the sanctions, also saw a contraction in production, in exports, and in markets. So in the wisdom of the conference, that it would be unfair to expect these three countries to join the others. So basically, to answer your question, it was quite an experience, but it reaffirmed my belief in a multilateral process, in consultations, both informal and formal, bilateral. The one of the most experienced diplomats in this world, probably after Lavrov and the late Turki Al-Faisal of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, is the current emir of Kuwait, who had been foreign minister and UN ambassador here for decades. I thought that it would be extremely helpful to sit down with him and get the benefit of his rich experience and wisdom. So I also decided to go to Kuwait and meet with him, and I was not disappointed. Deeply knowledgeable, highly experienced. He had been foreign minister, I think, since the early 60s. I took a very important quotation from him. After lengthy discussions, Q&A, at the end of it, he summed it up. He said, okay, I have listened to you. Thank you very much. But I want to tell you something, that from all what you have told me and the little that I know about your industry, I have made it a point of duty for the past 40 years to receive daily briefs of media reports around the world, but specifically on oil. This is my interest. So I know a little about your industry. What you have not said, I want to tell you. I strongly believe all stakeholders, particularly our leaders in this region, meaning the Middle East region, should do everything possible to depoliticize oil. Two, we should also do everything possible as leaders to insulate OPEC from our geopolitics.
Can I ask you about that? I just want to ask a couple of quick, brief follow-ups, and then I want to have time for Adrian and Antoine and open it up. So you mentioned geopolitics a few times now, and in the context of Doha, and reading between the lines, I think you were referring to the relationship between Iran and Saudi. Tell me if that's correct. And then if I am correct, can you tell us a little bit about what the dynamic is between Iran and Saudi and how that, notwithstanding a historically poor relationship right now, they were able to collaborate in the production agreement?
The completion of my encounter with the Emir of Kuwait will help to answer your question. He offered on his own. He said, okay, I can help you in one or two ways, but this is my firm belief. We must depoliticize oil. We must insulate you, OPEC, from our geopolitics. Therefore, let me tell you how I can help. I hope it works. I am going to meet King Salman in Bahrain at the GCC summit. I didn't know there was going to be a GCC summit, the one they just held in Bahrain. He said, I'm going to meet with King Salman, and I'm going to put this issue top of my agenda of my bilateral discussions with him. Secondly, I'm also going to meet with President Rouhani, and I will put this issue top of my agenda with him. And I will seek for audience as soon as possible with Prime Minister Haider al-Abadi. That jolted me on my seat. Yeah, and I think he saw my body language and my face. Then he said, listen, I understand you were in KOC yesterday. I said, yes, Your Highness. KOC, their national oil company, they have built a new museum showing the history of the industry from its inception through the various phases. One of those phases was the occupation of Kuwait by Iraq, and the infamous inferno, the fires of the oil wells, showing the over 700 wells that were set ablaze by retreating Saddam forces after the invasion. It was a very horrible sight, even looking at it as a documentary, probably the worst of its kind in the history of this industry. I said yes, and I shared my concern. She said, well, let me tell you a short story I received a request from the Prime Minister of Iraq for Kuwait, because of our experience, to come and help them with the fires that Daesh is putting on their northern fields. And he said, some of my ministers here were very much against it. And I told them no, that Iraqis are not our enemies. Our enemy had been taken by God. Iraqis are our neighbors, they're our brothers and our sisters, and they will continue to be forever. Therefore, whatever happens to them happens to us, and vice versa. So right now, I have my people, I have sent them equipment and resources, and we pray that they are able to extinguish those fires, not to have the experience that we had when we were invaded. I think there's some form of disconnect between the leaders and the geopolitics. Because when you talk to them, like I did, these are the key leading leaders of this region, I mean, they are all highly knowledgeable, very decent people, very measured, very considerate, and very positive. You don't hear these rhetorics that you hear from other lesser mortals who take upon themselves to continue to wage imaginary wars, complicating the situation in the region.
And do you, I'm curious if you could also comment on the role that U.S. shale is playing in the thinking about managing market stability for OPEC. So as prices now recover, we know that U.S. shale is able to work economically at much lower prices than people had expected. There's a range of estimates, but it could grow quite significantly next year. Mm. How much of a constraint is that playing on the thinking within OPEC about the ability to manage the market, because if you curtail production, the U.S. can replace some of that market share?
Thank you very much. This is a very important question. We in OPEC, we really admire the technological ingenuity and innovation that facilitated the shale revolution in the United States, because we all belong to the same industry. This industry has been driven by technological innovations from Drake's in 1859 to date, 25 barrels a day to now over 94, 95 million barrels a day going forward. To a large extent, is technological innovation. And the U.S. had been in the lead of these leaps and bounds. But what we saw with tight oil in the U.S. was phenomenal. It's something that the conventional sector of the industry globally should emulate. Come to think of it, Jason, without the shale revolution in the U.S. that we saw, what would have happened to the global economy? I mean, there was no capacity anywhere to meet the growing demand across the world. Thanks to shale and tight oil, we've been able to manage the situation. And through this period, talking to some of the shale operators, it's amazing how the combination of technology, managerial innovations, expertise and efficiency was able to midwife this revolution. And we look forward to continue to partner with them. We all belong to the same industry, the same market. The projections by my colleague that there will be about 40% growth in energy demand to 2040, out of it nearly 70 million barrels of oil. I mean, where are we going to get that? We need tight oil. So we in OPEC, we don't see tight oil as competitors per se. We see them as partners, as allies in this industry, and their experience is something worth looking at, even by such a distinguished center like yours.
Thank you. Adrian, let me bring you in. Tell us a little bit about the experience negotiating the deal as you did in the late 1990s. We haven't really talked yet about non-OPEC participation, so I'm also curious to hear your thoughts on Russia, on Mexico, and how credible those commitments are.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. You know, His Excellency's narrative of how the agreement came about was absolutely fascinating. And it reminded me of 1998. At that time, the two major stumbling blocks to reach an agreement were the production policies. I'm sorry, 1999. The two stumbling blocks to reach an agreement were the production policies of Venezuela and of Iran. And once the issue with Venezuela was settled, the only thing left was the very complex set of issues that arose with Iran. And there, king of Saudi Arabia had to intervene personally, and finally an agreement was reached. We all had to bend a bit backward with respect to what Iran was actually going to deliver. But it was enough to allow for an agreement, and it really took enormous effort by the king himself to get that done. So, you know, there's things that one remembers from the past in dealing with the present. I'm a bit intrigued about the current arrangement that has been reached with non-OPEC countries. In the case of Russia, clearly what is under discussion or was under discussion was the benchmark onto which we would link any sort of reduction of output by Russia, and to the compliance with that, because in the past Russia has not been a very credible player in sort of trying to manage a global supply. So that was a main, a key element of all of this, and I'd love to hear a bit more from you of how this came about, and not only how it came about, but what are your own expectations with respect to the agreement reached with Russia. Now, with the other developing non-OPEC countries, a new concept arose, which to me is a bit difficult to understand, and that is managed decline. You are betting that a number of other non-OPEC countries will reduce production through what in the communique appears as a managed decline. From my own experience, it is not any managed decline, it's simply decline that is happening in these countries. So I don't give too much importance to that part of the agreement, but a much greater importance to that with Russia. So I'd love to hear from you on how the deal with Russia came about. Now, I would also want to ask another question that has to do with rebalancing. You stated very clearly that the object of the OPEC agreement was to accelerate the rebalancing. That is, it's limited to that. We are going to accelerate rebalancing. Now, there's two measures of rebalancing. One is simply that the current level of supply becomes aligned with the current level of consumption, and that's fine. But there's a second, more stringent measure of rebalancing, and that is when stocks start to deplete at the, significantly, not just a small movement, but a significant depletion toward more normal levels of stocks. Now, if we use the second, more stringent definition, it would be very interesting to, if you could share with us your own views of when rebalancing under this second definition might come about. in the first half of 2017, the second half of 2017, or we will have, or will we have to go all the way to 2018, even with, you know, full compliance by everybody? I'm not questioning the, or I'm not putting on the table right now the compliance issue, which is an important one. So when do you see that coming about, that type of rebalancing? When will stocks really start to move down? You know, I know that it's much easier to look at current production and current consumption than looking at the stock movements, but and the nature of the data relating to price to stock movements. But I'd love to have your perspective, Your Excellency.
Do you want to comment quickly on Russia and the rebalancing question that Adrian?
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much, Adrian. I don't think I'm as much qualified as yourself to answer these questions, being an icon of this industry in your own right. But I will attempt to share with you my experience with the Russian Federation. Maybe you are referring to Oran in 2008 and previous attempts, I think, in 2001 and 1998, 2001. Was there 2003, Nadia? 2001. And then 2008 in Oran when we at the outset of the global financial crisis, when OPEC took that proactive decision to withdraw about 4.2 million barrels a day from the market in order to save the market and the global economy, and invited Russia and others to participate. Of course, history has shown that they had failed to play their own part of the bargain in Oran and in previous attempts. But what makes this current agreement with 11 non-OPEC member countries on Saturday, the 10th of December, different from previous attempts was that Russia, the Russian Federation, through the very able Minister Alexander Novak, has been in the forefront of efforts globally to restore stability in this market. You recall in my remarks, I made reference to the initial public meeting. There were several meetings behind the scenes, but the one that went public was on February 15th of this year in Doha, when Alexander Novak himself, with Ali Naimi of Saudi Arabia, and Mohammed Saad of Qatar, and Del Pino of Venezuela, met, and for the first time attracted global attention that probably producers were up to some form of action. I must tell you that that meeting was engineered more by Russia than any of the other three. And Alexander Novak had been in the forefront, and he had been consistent. And when I came on board in August, because we have an ongoing dialogue with the Russian Federation, OPEC Russia, similar to the one you are helping us to facilitate with the US, I had a Q&A with him. These same questions, Adria, I also posed to him. Please, as your partner in this dialogue, Mr. Novak, can you share with me what are you up to, you know? And he left me in no doubt that he had instructions from his boss, President Putin, to do everything possible to work with all members of OPEC and other members of non-OPEC to restore stability to this market. So he was open, very frank. He said everything was on the table. And he floated the idea of a freeze.
This was way back in February. But volumes had increased since then. So whether that concept of freeze was workable before Algiers or not, I think the numbers necessitated movement of positions from freeze to supply adjustments. And I must tell you that probably I interact with Minister Novak more regularly than many of my OPEC ministers because of the level of commitment of the Russian Federation. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Unfortunately, running short on time, but Antoine, come into this, and in particular, your thoughts on what role OPEC, how we should think about the importance and the role of OPEC in the oil market today. And one thing we haven't talked about yet, which if you could comment on, we've talked a lot about managing the market and market stability when prices are falling, but not when they're rising. And so one thing, if you want market stability, is the ability to put more supply in the market through spare capacity. There's a relatively low level today compared to historic levels. So what does that mean about the ability of OPEC to manage markets or provide some stability moving forward?
So, for me?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, thank you, Your Excellency, for your comments and for being here today. So building on what Jason just said, I think I would like, you referred in your comments to the policy platform and the technical platform. So I would like to ask you a question which is more technical, one which is more maybe policy oriented. And I realize that some of the issues are possibly difficult to address. But one of the points you made is one of the features of the recent agreement, which I thought, and this drives what Jason said, was very interesting and innovative, was the institution of a compliance committee to verify compliance of the member countries with the agreement. So I was just curious if you could just say in a couple of words, you know, how difficult or easy it was to come up with that feature, but also perhaps what real capacity that committee will have to monitor compliance, especially if it's composed of countries which will be under review. Will countries be able to find themselves in non-compliance? And what kind of enforcement mechanisms might there be in the event, however unlikely it might be or likely, of non-compliance? The second question I would have is, and I would go back a little bit to the presentation by Jorge, OPEC is not entirely about supply management and quotas. I realize this is what the attention has been focused on in the last few months, and that's what most of your work since you assumed office probably has focused on. But OPEC only started instituting production quotas in 1983, so for 23 years of its existence, it did not bother to monitor, to institute supply targets. And as the presentation by Jorge showed, OPEC is also much more than an organization that manages supply. It's also a research and a center of scholarship in its own right, just like Colombia. So I'm curious, what is your view of where OPEC fits in the broader context of the energy transition, moving out of oil? The forecast that you presented shows a decline in the pace of oil demand growth, even though it shows that hydrocarbons will continue to be the number one source of energy. But a declining source of energy whose contribution will be slowing. So I'm curious where you see OPEC fits in this broader issue of addressing climate change and dealing with the transition.
Thank you very much. On the compliance committee, it was the decision of the OPEC conference on November 30th. That returning to supply management after a sabbatical of so many years with its consequences, as we have seen from 2014, with all due respect to others who might feel otherwise, it was decided that there was need in order to enhance the credibility and the efficacy of the agreement to establish a joint ministerial monitoring committee between ourselves and the non-OPEC. Because by doing that, you are not only enhancing the credibility of the agreement, you are also binding the non-OPEC participating countries to this agreement. Hence, we established a joint committee of five, three from the OPEC side, two from non-OPEC. From our side, Kuwait is chairing this committee. Kuwait is a co-chair of this committee, including Algeria and Venezuela. From the non-OPEC side, when we met on Saturday the 10th of December, from their side, they nominated the Russian Federation, as well as the Sultanate of Oman. And the decision was that they will work with the OPEC Secretariat to assist them not only in drawing the mechanism for ensuring compliance, but also to provide them with the monitoring data, with the reviews, and other necessities to facilitate this work. I have been in constant touch with the incoming chairman of this committee, the newly appointed Kuwaiti minister, Mr. Esam Al-Mazrouk, who will be chairing this committee. I plan to meet with him as soon as possible to go through the issues. On the issue of the position of OPEC in this energy transition, taking into account the current state of climate change negotiations and agreements, all 14 member countries of OPEC have signed up to the Paris Climate Agreement. About six, I believe, have already ratified it. The rest are in the process of parliamentary ratification. So this, I believe, demonstrates the commitment of OPEC member countries as developing countries to participate in this global process of combating climate change. Being all developing countries, we are more impacted by the effects of climate change than probably most other parts of the world, despite the fact that all our economies are dependent on fossil fuels. We are also convinced that this is about our future, and as citizens of this world, we cannot insulate ourselves and hide behind short-term expectations and mortgage the future generations of our countries. So we are firm believers of this multilateral process, despite its shortcomings. I'm glad to see my colleague Haldo here. We've been negotiating climate change, I believe, Haldo, since INCs in New York before COP1. Here, yes, we negotiated the convention, the UNFCCC convention here in New York. And we've been through the process from Berlin COP1 up to Marrakesh a couple of weeks ago, COP22. So I think we have demonstrated the level of commitment of member countries, but of course we have issues, like all other parties have issues. Coming out of Marrakesh, it was very clear to me that the world community was waiting for the United States to show direction, to show leadership. Without the leadership of the United States in Paris, it would have been impossible to get that consensus, the Paris Agreement. President Obama has done an extremely commendable job, having learned from the sad experiences of Copenhagen, if you recall. And he did an extremely outstanding job in leading the build-up of this consensus in Paris. And because of our commitment, we also showed extreme flexibility. We have seen, for example, and Haldo will testify to those facts, that some of our key principles of the convention were sort of watered down in order to build this consensus. The principles of equity, if you recall, Haldo, the principles of common but differentiated responsibilities that you and I negotiated, although from different sides. But you are very understanding, very accommodating. the issue of energy poverty for developing countries, which has also been captured by the UN in its Millennium Development Goals. The classification of Annex I and non-Annex I parties, the developed country parties and developing country, and the commitment of the developed country parties, the Annex I, that has now been watered down to voluntary obligations under the INDCs with no binding consequences. This all shows the level of commitment of OPEC member countries that in order to move this process forward, to keep this multilateral process going forward, there is no sacrifice that is not worth doing. Because at the end of the day, it will be a win-win situation for the global community. So we are waiting for direction from Washington, and we hope the incoming administration, as soon as it finds its feet in Washington, will give this clear direction so that this process will continue in the interest of the entire global community and future generations.
I'm sorry we didn't I didn't manage time as well, so we didn't really have time for questions. We started a few minutes late, so I'll just say if there's one or two quick questions, we'll take 3 minutes to respond. And I should say, this is like we're all sitting up here playing the guitar and Bruce Springsteen's in the front row because we have Ed Morse here also. So if Ed wants to comment or ask a question or weigh in on anything you've heard, please do. David, and then over here. And then if maybe ask both questions together, we'll give you a chance to respond.
Okay. Following up a bit on your discussions on the climate change issue, OPEC has long had the idea of a fair price for the producer. I think the word ought to be fair return. If you're in a world with massive carbon taxes and things like that, the rent capture for the producer gets squashed. And that's very much worth, I think, paying attention to. The other thing that I think we all want to know, what did Putin say to the Iranians and what did Putin say to the Saudis? We have some speculations about maybe there was some Yemen in there, maybe there was something about religious legitimacy or whatever, trying to figure out what was worth 486,000 barrels a day plus half a neutral zone, I believe, to the Saudis for them to be as forthcoming as they were. I understand this is a difficult question, my friend, to talk about, but that's what we're thinking about. Thank you.
Let's take one more question here and then give you a chance to respond, and unfortunately that's...
Yeah, it's just a reiteration maybe of Adrian's question in terms of inventories. You had mentioned 300 above the five-year average, maybe what either a target for OPEC would be and or where, at what point in the future do we get to a kind of zero relative to the five-year average would be appreciated.
David, it's been a long time a friend, a resource person for me and OPEC as well, but I know from my Iranian friends that 2 days before the conference on the 30th of November, there was a phone call from President Rouhani to President Putin, and only God knows what they discussed, but we saw the results. I'm also aware that a few days before the meeting between OPEC and non-OPEC, there was a midnight call between Novak and Khalid Al-Falih, the minister of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and I confronted him when I heard about it. I heard from my sources that you had a 2 a.m. phone call, and he was like jolted. Who told you? I said, well, that's why I'm Secretary General. I have many friends and sources, you know. But did it take place or not? He said, yes, yes, it did. I must confess. And may I know what you discussed? Because I need to know. He said it was very positive. I think we will we will have an agreement. He's got instructions from his boss, and he wanted to clear with us where we stood in terms of the numbers, because Algeria and Venezuela, both ministers were in Moscow the following day. And I think they went with a lower number, according to their calculation. They went with a lower number that they needed from the Russian Federation in order to balance the equation. But based on what transpired on this 2 a.m. phone call, they agreed on 300,000, which is a higher number. Both Mr. Novak and Mr. Khalid Al-Fali, both of them confirmed to me before the meeting that yes, this phone call took place, and they agreed on that number, and that Novak wanted even a higher number in the Joint Monitoring Committee. Instead of two from non-OPEC, he wanted three. Khalid Al-Fali told him, okay, we are cutting 1.2. You total, we wanted 600 from you. That's 50%. So if you want a higher number in the Joint Monitoring Committee, you can raise your cut to a corresponding number that will give you additional seats. On the stocks, yes, if you see our projections, when you factor in the supply adjustment of 1.2 million from the baseline of October numbers for the six secondary sources, this would bring down stocks right up to the fourth quarter, drastically, I may say, according to the forward curve. But there would be an outstanding 60 million. If you look at that fourth quarter of 2017, meaning OPEC alone, if OPEC were to take this action alone without non-OPEC, yes, we will see the stock draw down, we will see the rebalancing, but that will take us to the fourth quarter with about 60 million stocks overhang over the five-year average. And that was what we used to negotiate with the non-OPEC. That, okay, we will act up to this point through the 1.2 million, but this is what will be outstanding. So we will not get the rebalancing will probably slip into 2018. So you needed to come in to clear the 60 million. And that was the basis of the negotiation, where we agreed on 558 from there. Thank you.
When you talk about market stability, do you have a particular price target or band in mind?
No. As a matter of policy, David knows very well that an A2, we have abandoned this many, many years ago on good advice and reasoning. We no longer target price. We look at the fundamentals, and in this case, the market has been out of balance. Why? Because of the oversupply that led to high stocks. Therefore, to rebalance the equation, you needed to address that variable of stocks. And the action that we took in Algiers on the 20th of September, in Vienna, 30th of November, and with the non-OPEC on the 10th of December, cumulatively, we'll be able to address this stubborn variable, I may call it, and bring this market to balance so that we will be able to achieve the elusive equilibrium price.
Last quick question. I just you mentioned the incoming administration and your many years of dealing with senior leaders in the energy sector. I'm wondering what you think of our new nominee for Secretary of State, Rex Tillerson.
Rex Tillerson, I know very well as a partner. ExxonMobil has been a long-time partner in Nigeria. In my days as CEO of our national oil company, he brings to this job vast knowledge, deep experience, not only in this global industry but in global affairs. He is a highly accomplished technocrat, an oil diplomat, a very successful manager who has managed one of the largest oil and gas companies in the world. I think the United States and indeed the world should be congratulated for having such an outstanding personality to step into the role of the Secretary of State. We're really proud of this nomination, and we wish him all the best. I think it's in the best interest of this world that is facing serious geopolitical challenges, especially in our own part of the world. So having somebody like Rex in the State Department, I think it's a major stabilizing factor to world peace and security.
So I want to thank everyone for joining us. I apologize that we didn't have a chance to take more questions, and I apologize we ran a few minutes over, but it was a fascinating conversation. We wanted to take as much advantage as we could of His Excellency's being with us here in New York. As I mentioned, the full video of this recording will be available in a few days online, along with all our other events on podcast. We'll be taking a short break for the holidays, and then I think as the new semester begins, our first event will be January 25th, a panel discussion to release the first book in the Center on Global Energy Policy's book series through Columbia University Press by Bob McNally, Crude Volatility, relevant to the conversation we're having today, about the history of boom-bust oil cycles and why we may, in his view, be in for more volatility ahead. I hope you'll join us for that. I hope you'll join me in thanking our speakers and especially thanking His Excellency Secretary General Mohammad Barkindo for joining us. Thank you.